Today I'm going to be taking a look at the brand new Flashforge Adventurer 4 3D printer, discussing its ease of use, talking about some of the more impressive features, and then I'm going to show you the print quality by printing off something incredible. Welcome back to another episode of STU'S Reviews. This is actually a prototype of the Adventurer 4 I was sent back in March, and I've been using it since then to get some ideas and opinions to share with you. And I've got lots to share. As a disclaimer, this review is going to be coming from the average user perspective, not somebody who might be a power user of 3D printers. So if you are that person sitting there and you're an absolute boffin with 60 different 3D printers in your house, this review might not be for you. But if you're the average user with interest in 3D printers already, or potentially somebody who's interested in 3D printers but hasn't already got one, then hopefully this episode will give you enough opinion on the Adventurer 4 for you to make a decision whether this is the right one or not. So with that said, let's take a look at the specs. The Adventurer 4 is Flashforge's newest addition to its lineup, featuring a fully enclosed workspace much like its smaller sibling, the Adventurer 3. The build volume sits at 22 by 20 by 25 centimeters, putting it firmly in the middle of standard consumer sizing. Its removable heated bed can achieve a maximum temperature of 110 degrees, and the extruder with the right nozzle can hit up to 265. It does have an inbuilt camera, and although the quality is sufficient, it's not the prettiest, with its primary use for checking the print hasn't turned into a spaghetti monster. It can print a variety of filaments from ABS, PLA, PC, PETG, PLACF, and PETGCF. Unarguably, this thing looks incredible and absolutely looks the part. But are these looks deceiving? First of all, let's talk about ease of use. Now, this is something that I reckon is in the forefront of most people's mind when looking at buying a 3D printer. And there's tons and tons of 3D printers out there. But the biggest problem I found is many of them come unassembled. You have to assemble the entire thing yourself. Now, I've actually tried to do this before with a 3D printer. I believe it was the Annette A6 or something like that. And that didn't go too well, partly because the instructions were utterly terrible, and also because I'm not the most patient person in the world when it comes to assembling things. This is why I'll never do anything like Lego. So what do you need to do to assemble the Adventurer 4 and get that up and going? Nothing. All you've got to do is plug the power cable in, plug the nozzle in, which I'll get onto in a minute, put some PLA or other filament in there, and you're done. It could not be simpler. This was one of the simplest processes to set up a 3D printer that I've experienced so far, and it was a massive round of applause for Flashforge when I found out how easy it was to set up. The only thing you might have to do is level the bed. Now, this does take a little bit of time, but it uses Flashforge's 9-point auto calibration system to do that, which is really, really straightforward. But here's a bit of a but. On the website, it says auto bed leveling. And I guess it does do it automatically. You don't have to manually adjust the bed. It does it all through the software. But auto to me sounds like it should do it itself. And it would be fantastic if you could just press a button and it did everything for you automatically and leveled that bed. That's something to consider. But to be honest, I leveled it once, and since then it's been perfect ever since. The design is otherwise wonderful, however, and this enclosed unit is beautiful. It does take up quite a lot of space for the build volume that it's capable of, but this enclosed unit, the positives far outweigh that particular downside. First of all, you've got a more sterile environment free from contaminants, dust or dirt or people prodding things. Because it's enclosed, you're not going to damage any prints that are on the way. Also, it's got a HEPA 13 filter, meaning that it's going to filter out pollutants from the inside, which is important if you're printing in things like ABS, for example. Also, it helps you create a better consistency in things like your temperature of your nozzle, temperature of your bed, and temperature of the print itself. So overall, the fact that this is fully enclosed is possibly one of my favourite features about the Adventurer 4. And the build volume is much bigger than the Adventurer 3, something that a lot of people were asking for. It's not just the extra build volume that has made this much bigger and quite a big unit. It's also the addition of something that will make a lot of people happy, and a lot of people are asking for this. It's the ability to use 1 kilogram spools in the spool holder on the side, which is fantastic. With the previous version, the Adventurer 3, you were stuck at around 500 gram half-size spools because it didn't have a very big spool holder on the side. There were modifications that people did, sort of external spool holders, but then having an external spool holder, you're taking away what we just spoke about, the fact that this is a fully enclosed unit and it is sealed from any contaminants. The fact that this now allows the 1 kilogram spools, people are going to love that. They've also added a magnetic build plate, which makes it so easy to remove your model. It has slight flex in it as well, so that you can pop the prints straight off. And that makes things so much easier, so I really like the addition of that magnetic build plate. You don't have any kind of fasteners, you just simply slide it in. And that's not the only thing that's quick release as well. So as I said earlier, the nozzle you've got to plug in, that's because these are changeable. They feature a really handy quick release system, and it's utterly ingenious, and it means that you can change out different nozzle specs much quicker. So if you want something with a higher temperature, you can add that in, or if you want something with a slightly thicker nozzle as well, you can simply swap that out. Of course, there is a slight downside to this. The downside here is that you'll have to source those particular nozzles from Flashforge, and this can get a little bit expensive. But I think for the fact that you can easily remove the entire assembly for cleaning, for changing to a different type of nozzle, I just think that that is invaluable. And again, that's something that outweighs the negatives. So overall, the design is fantastic. It's a much needed upgrade from the Adventurer 3. And there's some fantastic features on here that will benefit everybody, new and returning people to 3D printers. But a 3D printer is as only as good as its software. So how is that? It's actually surprisingly easy to use for novices and people who are returning to 3D printers. To get a 3D print going, all you need to do is find a model, put it onto your USB stick, show it in the front here, and away you go. You can even send it over internet through Wi-Fi or Ethernet if you've got either of those connected. And if it is connected to Wi-Fi or internet, you can even browse the Flashforge directory online and print from anywhere in the world. I could be in Spain right now and choose to print something from my printer, and it will just send it to it, print it for me so it's ready when I get home. I think that's fantastic, and that's something that I've never seen in a 3D printer that I've tried so far. A nice touch here is that it has some onboard memory to store the prints that you've printed, meaning if somebody removed the USB stick halfway through a print, it doesn't matter, because that print will have moved across onto the onboard memory. The same with losing internet connection. If your Wi-Fi drops, it doesn't matter. It can still print because it's had that stored on the internal memory, and that's a really nice touch to allow the printer to continue despite failures around it. It also has another failsafe as well when it comes to the power. If, for example, the power dies for whatever reason, then it will resume that print when the power comes back on. And that is just a really awesome feature. And together with the fact that it has that onboard memory to store the print, it just means that the likelihood of you having a really long print ruined by internet disconnection or USB stick disappearing or power going, those are mitigated, and you're not going to have any problems continuing a print and finishing it if any of those things happen. So a round of applause for that. But there is always a slight but, and that is that when the nozzle heats back up after resuming a print, or when you're starting a print, the retraction of the filament isn't enough, and you will get quite a lot of filament coming through at the very, very beginning, or obviously when you're resuming a print. Now, this can affect the print a little tiny bit, and it could be solved in the software if, say, for example, when it finishes a print, it retracts a bit of the PLA, so you're not getting as much pull through when it heats up. But to be honest, if you're using things like a raft or a brim, then that kind of extra little bit will just be deposited elsewhere, and you're not going to get any issues with the print. The only way that this will affect you really is when resuming a print after something like a power cut. As well as being able to resume a print halfway through if there's a power cut, you can also change the settings of the print halfway through. Now, for a lot of people, this won't be that relevant, but I found it extremely useful at trying to work out the best way to print with a very awkward type of filament. In here at the moment is some marble effect PLA, which I've used to print the incredible print, which we'll see in a few minutes, but it's awkward as hell. When I printed using the standard settings, which was absolutely fine with the white PLA that I'd used previously, it just didn't work. What was happening was essentially the outside was printing fine, but when it was printing infill, the structure on the inside of the print, it was stringing like hell. So the printer was obviously moving too fast, or not enough PLA was coming out. So halfway through, I decided to change some of the parameters, slow it down, increase the temperature, until it was printing that infill correctly. At which point I was able to restart that print with the new settings, and away I go. Now this ability to change it midway through was absolutely invaluable at finding the best possible settings for this particular PLA. And since then, I've moved on to print loads of stuff with this PLA with the same settings, and I've not had a single issue. It's very unlikely that you'll need to do this if you're using a standard color PLA, white, red, black. If you're using something particular, maybe like wood or metal or marble style filaments, you might need to change some of those settings midway through to get the best quality print that you can. But the ability to experiment, that's what I liked. So that's the printer itself. Now, what about the quality of the prints that come out of it? Now, in theory, every single printer should print the same quality if they've got the same abilities. So if you've got it set at 0.2 millimeters, then it should print the same quality, but that's always often not the case. But since having this, I've printed loads of stuff. I've printed a Game Boy stand, a Raspberry Pi case, some tool clips, obviously a benchy boat, which is used as the standard for 3D printer tests, which came out very well at super high resolution. You can hardly see the layers with the naked eye. But I wanted to test it with something harder, something more challenging, something that would fill the maximum volume of what this thing can print, something with detail, something with support, potentially something with a few 3D model errors in it as well to see how well the printer handled that. So I came up with my own idea and designed my own thing to print to see how well it managed. Printed in the awkward marble PLA over 36 hours at a slow 32 millimeters a second and at a soaring heat of 226 degrees, I give you STU'S Caesar. At a standard resolution of 0.2 millimeters per layer, it's come out as an utter work of art, and so has the print. But I'm more than impressed about how this printer has performed. Other than a few small areas where the supports are attached to the model, this thing looks near perfect, and I am super impressed how well this has come out. It barely looks like a 3D printed model, and this was at standard resolution as well, so I am massively impressed. And the thing is, to go even further, this thing and the software that Flashprint provide completely knocked it out of the park with the errors of that model. Now, I'm not a 3D model artist at all, and I have no idea what I'm doing. All I did was I scanned my face using the Hedges app from the App Store. I took that scan and then spliced my own face onto a statue of Julius Caesar using Blender by essentially using the rudimentary sculpting tools and dragging his face behind my own. If you hide my face, this looks absolutely horrific. But you can see how bad this 3D model is. There's lots of weird little artifacts everywhere, vertices and faces that shouldn't be there. It's just a huge thumbs up from me with the fact that this can take an utter cowboy of a botched job splicing two models together and make something as perfect as it has done. So I am utterly amazed. So the price of this thing comes to $799, which is around, if it translates directly, about £550. Now, I think that is a fantastic price for the level of features that you get in this thing. It is on the more expensive side of some of the same volume 3D printers out there, but I think the features that this thing has puts it in a league of its own, and it almost makes it a professional level printer in my eyes. I just think it's incredible. I love the locks, I love the size. I love the feature set. And I think people who are new to printing are going to find this incredibly easy to use. And I think those that aren't new to printing, who already have 3D printers, are going to love some of the more advanced features of this thing. And I'm going to love the ability to print out some really complex things with simplicity. And that concludes my review of the Flashforge Adventurer 4. A fantastic upgrade on the Adventurer 3. It's really obvious that Flashforge have listened to people's feedback on that particular model and implemented what people want in this. Like I said, the only two things that I feel that they could improve upon is maybe changing the software so that it retracts the PLA before it ends the print, so that on the next print you're not getting a bit of runoff. But also I would love to see some form of absolute automatic leveling, so you can press a button and it just completely automatically levels it for you without having to manually change the height of that nozzle in the software. But other than that, this is damn near a perfect printer for everybody. If you enjoyed today's episode and you found it helpful at all, don't forget to hit that like, hit that subscribe and hit that notification bell for more STU'S reviews when they land. But as always, I will leave a link in the description below, and I will see you back for another episode of STU'S reviews soon.